All right, so we're in chapter 44 here, and it starts with the phrase, but now, in the New American Standard Version, which we've been using, but now. Well, chapter 43 began with, but now. So I'm going to talk about my but now theology, means here's the good news coming. I've been saying to you week by week, the Bible only says really two things. The prophets of Israel say only two things. They say the situation is chaos and very, very bad right now. You're not doing well. But wait till I set this right and everything will be changed. So the but now means now let's look at something cheerier, heartening, the reversing of the bad things that were mentioned before. 44:1, but now listen. That's a Shema thing. Listen, pay attention to this Jacob, which is another word for Israel, by the way. He's the head of the Israelite people. So Jacob is the name of the nation here. All of you Jacob people, my servant. Now you stop at every word when you read the Bible and you read whole sections of it if you can. Whole chapters, whole sections, even 40 chapters at a sitting sometime. And you fill your mind with scripture so that you're meditating on it when you wake up in the morning. And as you go to sleep at night, you are thinking about these extraordinary words. My servant, Jacob is a servant. Israel is to be a servant. You, as a Christian, are to be a servant of God. You've been employed by God to do his work. So you think about what you're doing as servant. Jacob is a servant. Israel is a servant. We, the church, are called the Israel of God. Let's understand that. The Israel of God in Galatians 6:16. That doesn't mean that God has finished with ethnic or Jewish Israel, as we know it in the Middle East. God has not finished with them. They have not been replaced forever, but right now they're not doing very well because they haven't accepted the Messiah. Meanwhile, then you step in as the international church of God. You are called the Israel of God. You're even called a holy nation in 1 Peter. So you are in a very privileged position, thanks to God calling you into his truth. Verse 2 says, the Lord who made you and formed you from the womb, who will help you. These are very encouraging words. God formed you, so to speak, from the womb, literally formed Jesus from the womb. He began in the womb of his mother Mary by miracle. And who will help you? God will help you, provide you're looking to him and to Jesus for that help that you need day by day, moment by moment. Don't be scared, Jacob. Include yourself here. You are part of this spiritual Jacob, if you like. You may not be a literal descendant of Israel, that's true, but you count as the Israel of God. Don't be scared. Nothing to be scared of. You're my servant, and Yeshurun, that's a very rare word for Israel. You'll find in your margin there, it occurs in Deuteronomy. Yashar is the Hebrew for being upright, so it's a positive title for the upright people who are to be God's people. You've been chosen. Americans talk about nothing but elections these days. Everything is who's going to govern. Well, you are the ones chosen eventually to govern the world. You're the elect. Now look at this wonderful material in verse 3. God puts you in a laboratory, so to speak, where you can observe what's going on outside. I looked through my window this morning. I saw the grass is actually beginning to go green again. Well, who fixed that? Who managed that? And then Barbara, my wife, and I looked up, and there were geese in the sky flying in formation. Who planned all that? The answer is God. So you give thanks to God for the marvel of his creation, which you see if you're looking for it. In the beauty of flowers, the cry of the geese, and Barbara was telling me that when one at the front of the geese, the flock of geese gets tired, somebody else takes over. All of that is happening, but are you noticing it? Or are you really not paying attention to the amazing hand of God? Okay, I will pour out my spirit in verse 3. Let me do verse 3. I will pour out water, that's a symbol of the Spirit of God, on a thirsty land. That's the bad news. The land is thirsty. I'll pour out water on it, streams on the dry ground. And then in parallel, I will pour out my spirit. The Spirit of God is not a third person in a Trinity, never a third person, but it's very personal because my spirit is coming to you now, my disposition, my mood, very much personal. And God's spirit, or the spirit of Jesus, they would be experienced without distinction, you couldn't tell the difference, but it's not a third person, but it's still very personal as being the personal spirit, mind, heart of God or Jesus. So that's what God is going to do on a grand scale when he sends his son back to reverse the chaos that is our world right now. The bad news is it's very bad. The good news of the gospel of the kingdom, and I recommend when you say gospel for the rest of your life, you always say gospel of the kingdom because people don't know about that. So you go on repeating it until they hear it from you all the time. Look at verse 4. They will spring up among the grass. So all of these beautiful pictures from nature, the grass getting green, the springs of water, and one person in this happy day that's coming, the kingdom of God day, will say, I am the Lord. I belong to Yahweh or Jehovah or the one God of Israel. I'm his. I belong to him. You can say that right now because you've been called and elected in advance of the coming of this great day of the kingdom. And one will call on the name of Jacob. To call on somebody's name is to appeal to them. In the Bible, your name is not just how you spell your name, J-A-N-E or whatever it is, not how you spell it. It is everything that you are and everything you stand for is your name. So you call on God and everything he stands for and everything he is. And they'll name themselves with the name of Israel. They'll call themselves Israel people. You are the Israel of God right now. You can be so very thrilled with your identity as the Israel of God, Galatians 6:16, verse 6. Thus says the Lord, in my Bible, all capital letters, when you have all capital letters, L-O-R-D, that means that behind that is the Hebrew word Yehovah, which might be the right pronunciation, but it doesn't matter. And also Redeemer. God is a Redeemer. That's the word that tells you you've been bought back from the slave market, where all of us, before we were converted, were slaves to sin. God has bought us back using his son to die on our behalf, to die for our sins, the crucifixion and the atonement, of course. We've been bought back, redeemed, that's what redeemed means, from the slave market. Look at verse 6. I am the first and I am the last. That's God. How many persons is that? I am. Come on, this isn't hard. It's beautifully simple. And people say, well, this is boring doctrine. We don't need doctrine. We just need Christian living. That's a falsehood. You need every word of the truth because it's not good to have nonsense in your head. And if you think that I really means three, then your mathematics are very poor, but your misunderstanding who God is. So God keeps saying over and over, I am the first. I'm the A of the alphabet and I'm the Z of the alphabet, the Alpha and Omega. No God besides me. How many persons is me? Who is like me? Me. Let him proclaim and declare it. Let him confront me, beginning with my establishing by the ancient nation. Then let them declare to them the things that are coming. In other words, God is mocking human beings, saying, can you predict the future like God can? Of course you can't. Get a clear sense of your position, your frailty before the one God of Israel. You can't predict the future like God does. So he's mocking the human race. He has to do that because we're so stubborn and so stupid that we need to be corrected all the time by the Bible. Verse 7, who is like me? Nobody, of course. From the time that I established ancient people of Israel, let them, if they can do it, he's being sarcastic really here, let them declare the future just and try to be like God. You can't do that. Verse 8, do not tremble, do not be afraid. Have I not long since announced it to you and declared it? And you are my witnesses. Now, this is the positive side. You are my witness. This is legal language. The Bible is a legal book. The Bible is our constitution. And if you're a believer, you are one of God's witnesses. When you speak for God, you're a witness for God. Most important legal term. So you'd better speak the truth for God. Otherwise, he might cancel you as an inadequate witness. But God is comforting us here. You are my witnesses. Is there any God beside me? Of course not. I know of none. About every third or fourth verse in the Bible, God says that he's one person. And we're so slow, so tied to our tradition. And Jesus was very upset with the Pharisees because they kept saying, our tradition, what we think is right, in fact, is not right. So if you want to be lost, if you want to lose your salvation and fail, then you are going to witness to falsehood. Don't want to do that. So you pray, oh God, help me to witness to the truth. And a witness is a gospel word, the gospel of the kingdom. Now he, in verse 9, he begins to talk in further mocking terms about people who are fashioning graven images. You might say, well, today we don't go around making physical images. That's true, we don't. But we create our own gods, false lords in our mind. Let's say an overemphasis on sport. The thing that really gets us excited about is sport, or music, or a film star, or even our job. We might have turned that into an idol. So you look at yourself and you say, what is my real idol? There's a massive emphasis in America today on patriotism. There's nothing wrong with that in itself. But if your nation, the nation of America, is your real idol, then you've put America in place of God. We need to examine ourselves on that count. So idolatry then comes in different forms. People talk about women's rights, by which they mean women's rights to murder their baby. What? That's an abominable thing for God. So you do your best then to promote good things. We talk now about marriage between two of the same sex, or we speak to children and say, well, you don't know really whether you're male or female. That is abominable stuff. That is going to bring the wrath of God on all of us. So we stay away from that sort of nonsense and go back to the old traditional views of one man, one woman in marriage. All of that needs to be part of who you are and what you say. Look at this in verse 11. All his companions will be put to shame. Shame is a very bad word in the Bible. He who is ashamed of me, Jesus said in the Gospels, I'm going to be terribly ashamed of him in the judgment. So you don't want to be ashamed of the words of Jesus. You speak them boldly and kindly. But look at this about shame in verse 11 there. They're going to be put to shame. If you're into idolatry, if you think that some film star is about as good as Jesus, you're going to be terribly ashamed of that. So don't do it. Look at this. All his companions will be put to shame, for the craftsmen themselves are mere men. People who fashion these idols, these people who promote patriotism to a higher level than God or Jesus, are going to be terribly ashamed. Let them all assemble themselves. Let them stand up. Let them tremble in verse 11. Let them together be put to shame. Shame is a negative word. You don't want to be ashamed. You want to be proud in a right sense and pleased and thrilled with the words and the teachings of Jesus. Now, verse 12, he gives you a vivid picture here of how one creates an idol, either in your mind, in our case, often in verse 12, a man shapes with a cutting tool. He gives you a vivid picture of here. Watch this man creating an idol. He measures it. He marks it with chalk and so on, works it with planes, outlines it with a compass, makes it like the form of a man, the shape of a man or an animal. Often they did. Doesn't matter. Some of us have created idols in our mind. We've measured them all out. So that's the application for us today. Surely he cuts cedars for himself. The Bible is full of references to trees, by the way. And human beings are supposed to be like trees planted by the riverside. We're blessed in our property here in Georgia to have a stream, that rather substantial stream, that never fails all year long. It's spring fed from a spring off the property. And somehow that water keeps rushing in there day after day after day. Nobody primes it. Nobody fixes it in any way mechanically, but it's simply there. So this is a reminder of trees planted by the riverside. We have actually, right outside my window, an oak by the stream of water. How vivid is that? Verse 15, talking of the mockery and the stupidity of idolatry. So he warms himself by the fire. He says he also makes a fire to bake bread. He gets his food from building fires, of course. Makes a god and worships it. How dumb is that? So examine yourself carefully and say, what is it in your life that is the idol that prevents me from giving God his due reverence. 17, the rest of it he makes into a god. Well, we don't do that physically today very much, I know that. But we do it at the equivalent level of a spiritual false god. He makes it into a little g god, graven image. Then he bows before it, worships it, prays to it, and prays to this thing or his secret idol, whatever it may be, and hopes that that will deliver him. It won't work. The only person who can deliver you would be the one, only true God through his unique son. They don't know. God is mocking these atheists. They don't understand because he has besmeared their eyes. Can you imagine getting grease or something and wiping it across your eyes? Your vision is impaired. That's the problem with a lot of religious people, and their hearts cannot comprehend. Note that in the Bible, your heart is not the seat of your emotions. It's the center of where you operate. Mainly the mind and the intellect is the heart. So when people say, well, you've got too much emotion and not enough heart, they're not talking anything that is biblical language at all. Your heart is the center of your intellect where you do your thinking. They cannot comprehend. So you pray then, day to day, oh God, if I'm not understanding correctly, please take away the veil over my eyes so that I see clearly. Look at the mocking tone of God in 44:19. No one recalls, that's to say most people don't, nor is there knowledge or understanding to say. These people who make their idols are not able to say to themselves, I've burned half of it in the fire. I made my bread over all this. I roasted my meat on it, and I'm eating my food from having burned this fire. Then I make the rest of it into an abomination. That's a very strong word. Shikuts in Hebrew. That's a disgusting thing in God's sight. Abominable. Shikuts. You can hear the word is even ugly. An abomination. Because it's only fire that you made. You burned this thing that you fashioned so carefully. That's a disgusting image. And you fall down in front of this block of wood and say, this is a god. Or you fall down in front of your favorite thing that you've put in the place of God. That's disgusting. You're absolutely revolting in God's sight if you do that. You're feeding on ashes. Can you imagine having ashes for breakfast? That's terrible. A deceived heart or mind has turned him aside. He cannot save himself, and he's unable to say, don't I have a lie in my right hand? Isn't that powerful? To have a lie in your right hand is to believe something that is false and not be willing to see that it's false. So wherever you may have a difference in understanding that is radically different from everybody else, you need to say, is this possibly a lie in my right hand? Let me get rid of it. And then you'll be very pleasing in God's sight. Over there in 21, remember these things, Jacob. I formed you. I'm your creator. You're my servant. You're supposed to work for me, O Israel, and you will not be forgotten by me. These are the comforting words. Don't be scared. I haven't forgotten you. You're my servant. But for goodness sake, get rid of the lie that may be hiding in your right hand. That's powerful stuff. Return and look at the joy in verse 23. Shout for joy. When's the last time you shouted for joy? Shout for joy. In verse 23, for the Lord has done it. Shout joyfully, you lower parts of the earth. That's the highest heaven and the lowest parts of the earth, the extremes of up and down, forest and every tree in it. For the Lord has redeemed, he's brought back his true people. And in Israel, he shows forth his glory. That word glory should be written in all caps, capital G-L-O-R-Y. Glory is a synonym, the same word in meaning as the future kingdom. The gospel is about the kingdom of God. The gospel is about the future glory of God. When God intervenes to come and make out of the present chaos something that is indescribably beautiful and glorious. So glory is a synonym for the kingdom. Then we'll get to the last section here, verse 24. Now we're talking about the 8th century BC, when Isaiah wrote these amazing words. That's a long time ago, 8th century before Christ even. But all of this has a very modern application to you and me now. Because as I've said to you before, the Bible is a very economically clever book. It can say one thing and mean about three things at the same time. In other words, Israel in the Old Testament meant the nation of Israel. You are now the Israel of God. That says that there were two Israels. That's right. And there was a Cyrus in the 8th century BC. And there's going to be a future restorer of Israel. Did you know that Cyrus in the Bible is called a Messiah? He's a Christ figure. Why? Because he restored the people of Israel back to their land. That's only one thing, only one occurrence of that. Brilliant idea. So focus your mind now on Jesus, the true Messiah. Cyrus is said to be God's anointed there in 45:1, beyond the chapter that we're doing today. Cyrus is a Messiah. That means a royal figure. God is very interested in royalty. Messiah is a royal kingly title. And Cyrus, in history, was used as a messianic figure to regather Israel. There it is. So God is claiming his marvelous identity again in chapter 44:24. I made everything by myself. The Hebrew there says, who was with me? The answer is nobody. I mean, God is really pouring out his heart to us human race to say, let's get straight on who God is. And he causes all the fake teachers in verse 25 to fail, making fools out of their attempts to do theology, causing wise men to draw back in 25, turning their knowledge into foolishness. As some of those quotations that Carlos was giving you earlier, it's complete folly to say that this one is God, this one is God, this one is God, but that makes one God. It doesn't. That was simply nonsense. A famous man at Harvard, Andrews Norton, said he became a Unitarian by his own study, and he said, it's simply nonsense. The whole theology of three is one and one is three, and there are three personal distinctions in the Godhead. That doesn't mean anything. It was the area, Andrews Norton said, of words without meaning. Don't prostitute your precious gift of language and logic to nonsense like God is three, but he's really one. Three personal distinctions. Carlos gave you some excellent examples of that earlier on. So here we have then a joyful, joyful message in these last verses of chapter 44. God is confirming his word in 26. Now look at this. It is I, God, who says of Jerusalem, she's going to be inhabited. That hasn't happened fully yet. It did happen as a kind of a sample, as a pattern in Old Testament times, 8th century BC. Cyrus did say, hey, all you Israelites, come back and go back to your land. That happened. That's not the end of the story. This is going to happen again because Israel, the nation, I'm talking about the nation now, what we roughly call Jews, Paul calls Israelites. And you, the church, are the Israel of God, but you're not called Israelites. So national Israel is going to be scattered and punished yet again. Can you imagine this? God has to get our attention sometimes by punishing us. And he's going to have to do that to wake up the Israelite people, the literal Jews, wherever they may be, primarily in the land of Israel. They're there, but they're not there in faith. They did go back to the land in 1948. This was very interesting because it meant that other prophecies could then be fulfilled. But they're still going to build a temple. That has to happen. And that temple will be invaded by the abomination of desolation, a disgusting false teacher. And then finally, when they suffer terribly from that punishment, they will come to their senses. So there's an ultimate restoration that you always see in these words which described former patterns. These were just shadows of things coming in the future. Here you have it exactly in chapter 44 that we're doing this morning. It is I who says of Cyrus in verse 28, He's my shepherd. He's my pastor. Cyrus is a historical figure, a messiah, actually. He's a type. He's a pattern. He's an outline, a shadow, not the real thing, but a shadow of Messiah, who is the true messianic Cyprus. You could say that Messiah Jesus is the ultimate Cyrus. There it is in verse 28. God said of Cyrus, he's my shepherd. Well, God said of Jesus, he's my pastor. Who is your pastor? Nobody on earth. Your pastor is Jesus. He's the one responsible for taking care of you, and you're the one responsible for obeying and following him. He, Cyrus, and Jesus, of course, and anybody who functions well as a pastor, will carry out all my desire. So a Cyrus or a Messiah, be it the Cyrus who is a pattern, a sort of foreshadowing, or be it the real Messiah, Jesus, he's going to carry out all my desire. That's exactly what Jesus prayed when he said, may your desire be done. May your will be done. May your kingdom be established on the earth. The Bible is looking forward breathlessly, with a breathless excitement about the future time coming when Jesus returns in a one single parousia. That's the Greek word that we use for the second coming. There's no pre-tribulation rapture, no double second coming in Scripture. That's a falsehood, a false hope. That's another subject. But Christ is coming back once, visibly, to do what Cyrus in the 8th century BC did imperfectly, but as a shadow, as a pattern, as an example. So there it is. It is God in verse 27 who says to the depths of the sea, dried up. God can absolutely dry up the sea. He has that sort of power. He can bring water where no water is, and he can take away water where water exists. That's what he did at the creation. He will perform all my desire. But you are a messianic figure too. You, as a Christian, are a kind of Cyrus, a kind of messianic figure, because you're supposed to be doing the will of God. Jesus was intent on doing the will of God. Jesus is going to rule the world, and you, according to many scriptures, are going to rule and fix the world with Jesus when he comes back. So all of this material applies to you quite precisely, though it also applied to Cyrus in the 8th century BC and applies fully and ultimately to Jesus. And he declares of Jerusalem, you're going to be built. That's looking forward to a time when Jerusalem will have been ruined. There's coming a time called the Great Tribulation, in which terrible suffering is going to occur in Israel. You can look at that on your own in Zechariah chapter 13 and 14. We won't turn there now. There's going to be a terrible disaster in the Middle East. Before that, there's going to be a pseudo-temple built, a temple built in sincerity, no doubt, but it will not be a temple that God finally approves, because the Antichrist, otherwise known as the abomination of desolation, the disgusting, abominable person, will sit in that false temple and declare himself to be God. So all of this stuff about your eyes being smeared over and not having understanding, I must just refer very quickly to 2 Thessalonians 2. Paul was very interested in this material in 2 Thessalonians 2. Look at this in verse 8. That lawless one will be revealed. Talking about the future Antichrist. He's going to be revealed, who is going to kill. Jesus is going to kill this man. That's a great relief. But look at this person in verse 9 of 2 Thessalonians 2. That evil person has a parousia. So watch out, on the landscape, we don't know when, we're not setting any dates, there will be a fake, false, phony, messianic figure. He'll be revealed. And the Lord Jesus, in verse 8 of 2 Thessalonians 2, the Lord Jesus will kill him off and bring him to an end with the appearance of Jesus's parousia. And in verse 9, this evil guy has a fake pseudo-parousia. He has a pseudo-second coming. Amazing material. In accordance with the activity of Satan, who is the great god of this age, a fake, phony person, if ever there was one, and it's going to be accompanied by miracles, would you believe it? With all the deception of wickedness, look at verse 10, all the piling up of words here, all the deception of wickedness for those who are perishing. And I used to say to the students when I was teaching in the Bible college, If you want to perish, here's how to do it. If you want to perish, here's what you do. They're perishing. Why? Because, this is you now being addressed, they did not receive the love of the truth, as I say, a disgusting hatred of error and a passion for truth in order to be smart. No, no, no. In order to be saved rather than lost. And if you decide not to have a love of the truth, here's what happens. For that reason, if you don't love the truth, God will send you then a deluding influence so that you wind up believing what is false. That's a challenge for all of us. That's exactly what Isaiah in chapter 44 has in mind. Their eyes have been smeared over. They're not able to say, listen, I've got a lie in my right hand. So where you have a different opinion on some major doctrine, please take that seriously. It is not sufficient to say, well, that's my opinion, your opinion. No, no, that's not going to do. Because Paul said, I want you all to say the same thing. We Christians are under judgment with 50,000 denominations until we all say the same thing. We've got a lot of work to do in order to love that truth in order to be saved. So I think that's a fitting comment on Isaiah 44. And look at the very end of 44:28 in Isaiah, where we're finishing today. God is going to say to the real founders of the genuine temple when Jesus comes back, not a fake abomination of temple that's going to precede, but he's saying of Cyrus, he's my shepherd, my pastor. He's going to do exactly what I want him to do, Cyrus and Jesus in the future. He's going to say to Jerusalem, she, the city, will be built, and of the true ultimate temple. Now, I said the book, the Bible is very economic. The temple is a literal building in the future. It was a literal building in the past, but you are also called the temple of God. You are a building. You are a temple, not the temple. You are a temple, and your friends, colleague, Christians are a temple. You're also called the Israel of God. You're God's servants and God's people. So we'd better measure up to that colossally high calling. You're representing the very God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. You're representing the very Messiah, Jesus. So what sort of people should we be? Tracy was telling us very forcefully this morning about how we should be. We should be willing to love less by comparison, even our own family. Jesus put it very, very vividly, as Tracy was pointing out. You're supposed to hate your family. That doesn't mean what we hear by that in English. Let's make that quite clear. You're not to hate anybody, but you're to love less by comparison, even your favorite film star, your favorite movie, those things that you cherish, your favorite sport, all of that must be at a secondary level than the passion that you have for the truth in order to be saved. 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 10. So let's finish on that climactic point, and I hope that you've got something of the grandeur of God and his enormous plan for the world.